Hello friends, today our topic is acute otitis media. Today we'll be studying about the definition of the acute otitis media, etiology, the common organisms causing AOM, roots of the spread of infection, pathology of the acute otitis media along with its stages, its signs and symptoms, its complication and management. Talking about the normal middle ear anatomy. Now this is the middle ear cleft. This is the normal middle ear cleft. It consists of Eustachian tube anteriorly with the middle ear, the attic, the additus connecting the middle ear with the mastoid antrum and the mastoid air cells. This whole consists of middle ear cleft. Talking about the normal anatomy of the tympanic membrane, this is the pars tensa, separated from the pars flaccida above it by malleolar folds. This is the posterior malleolar fold, this is the anterior malleolar fold. This is the handle of malleus. The tip of the handle of malleus is called umbo, with the cone of light in the anteroinferior quadrant. Now, the definition of the acute otitis media. As we all know, acute otitis media is generally a condition more commonly seen in children. It can also be seen in adults, but it is more common in children. So, it is an acute viral or a bacterial infection of the middle ear and the mastoid air cell system that results in the mucosal inflammation, and this results in the middle ear effusion with various signs and symptoms. So there are many risk factors. The risk factors are more commonly seen in children, and this includes the recurrent upper respiratory tract infection. Now what do you mean by upper respiratory tract infection? So the upper respiratory tract includes nose, paranasal sinuses, the pharynx and the larynx. So any acute infection of these structures will lead to or will increase the chance of acute otitis media. This includes sore throat, tonsillitis, rhinitis, pharyngitis, laryngitis. Sore throat is or pharyngitis are similar. It consists of infection of the pharynx or the mucosa of the pharynx. Tonsillitis is similar to that. Tonsil are the lymphoid tissue present in the oropharyngeal region. Now, infection of these tonsils or the lymphoid tissue will lead to its inflammation and pain. This is tonsillitis. Rhinitis is the inflammation of the mucosa of the nose. Laryngitis is the inflammation of the mucosa of the laryngeal region. Or as the ear, the nose and the throat are connected with each other, infection of one structure might lead to the spread of infection to the other structure. Similarly, there is a racial factor which leads to increase in the occurrence or the incidence of the acute otitis media. Genetic influence is also seen. Those children who are more prone to allergic conditions like allergic rhinitis, allergic pharyngitis are also more prone to acute otitis media. The studies have been found that the mother and the children who have group A blood group are more prone to acute otitis media. Now, some other conditions like that of lower socioeconomic class, overcrowding, use of pacifier, all this will lead to more chances of acute otitis media, as this will lead to more spread of the infection. The lower socioeconomic class is also more prone to the infection. Now, talking about the MCQs in pre-PG exam or in NEET PG, you might be asked question about the risk factors for the acute otitis media. They'll be asking four different options. You have to select the correct one or the most correct one. Now, organisms causing acute otitis media. There are viral infections causing acute otitis media and there are bacterial infections. Viral infections are more common compared to the bacterial infection, and the most common one is the respiratory syncytial virus. The other viruses are human rhinovirus, adenovirus and so on. In bacterial infections, the Haemophilus influenza is the most common virus. In pre-PG exams, this question is frequently asked. What is the most common agent causing the acute otitis media? You are given different options of bacterial and viral. If both viruses and bacteria are given in the option, you have to select the viral cause because it is the commonest. About 60 to 90% of the causative agents are viral causes. But if you are given only the bacterial causes, then you have to choose Haemophilus influenza. Now, the spread of infection. as we already know, this is the middle ear cleft. This is the eustachian tube. This is the middle ear with all the ossicles, and it is connected with the mastoidentrum through the adytus entrum. So, if there is, and we already studied about the risk factors. So, if there is any infection in the nasopharyngeal region or in the nose, there might be spread of infection through the eustachian tube into the middle ear, causing the inflammation of the middle ear mucosa. See, here the anatomy of the middle ear is clearly seen with the ossicles. The middle ear is connected with the inner ear. This is the inner ear. This is the cochlea. This is the vestibule along with its semicircular canals and the nerve supply. The cochlear part and the vestibular part. And this is the external part of the ear. So the spread of infection can be through any route. The first one we already discussed was through eustachian tube. The second one is through external ear. If there is any damage to the tympanic membrane, there might be spread of infection through the external ear into the middle ear, causing acute otitis media. If and when proper care is not taken, the infection might get converted into a chronic one, causing chronic otitis media as well. The third and the least common route is the blood vessels. As we all know, all these structures in the body needs nutrition. This nutrition is supplied by the blood vessels. Now, any systemic infection might get spread to the middle ear through the blood vessels, but this is the least common route. So these are the three main mode of route of spread of infection. Now, talking about the presenting symptoms, it's always like the patient are more commonly in pediatric age group. It is not that the adults will not get affected, but it is rarely seen in adults. Those who are more prone in adults, they will have acute otitis media, but it is not that commonly seen. So if any patient, pediatric or adult, will have acute otitis media, they will present with complaint of earache. The most common symptom is earache. The second most common symptom is hearing impairment or decrease in hearing. The third is discharge from the ear. As the patients are more in the pediatric age group, sometimes they are not able to speak, and the parents come with the complaint of excessive crying of the children with the fever and irritability. Sometimes patient will have clumsiness and ear pulling. But any adult will come with clear-cut complaint of earache, hearing impairment or discharge from the ear. These are the main complaints of the patient. Now, talking about the pathology. So, there are various stages of acute otitis media. There are four main stages. We'll talk about it one by one. So the first stage is stage of tubal occlusion. Here, as we studied about the route of the spread of infection, the infection might get spread from the nasopharynx into the middle ear through the eustachian tube. So if there is a blockage of eustachian tube, there will be decrease in the middle ear pressure, leading to the retraction of the tympanic membrane. So what will be the symptoms of this stage? The patient will come with the complaint of earache and decreased hearing, but there might not be any fever present. With this complaint, we do not get exact idea about the condition of the middle ear. So we do otoscopic examination. Now, on otoscopic examination, we can see a retracted tympanic membrane. So this is the retracted tympanic membrane. It's a prominent handle of malleus, and there will be loss of light reflex. Now, this condition can be, or this stage can be, easily confused with another condition, which is serous otitis media. It is also commonly seen in children. Here also patients sometimes have earache. Here also patients sometimes have decreased hearing. So we have to make sure whether it is the initial stage of the acute otitis media or whether it is serous otitis media. So if there is any recurrent upper respiratory tract infection, we might get some idea about the stage of the, or the type of the disease. The second is the stage of pre-suppuration. Here, this is the second stage, and the patient will complain of severe earache. There will be severe hearing impairment. If it is a child, if the patient is a child, the patient will have fever. There will be restlessness and ringing in the ear sensation. On otoscopic examination, there will be marked congestion of the tympanic membrane. See, this is the tympanic membrane with congestion. The external auditory wall is also congested. There will be cartwheel appearance of the tympanic membrane, we can see the leashes of the blood vessels going in the radial direction from the center into the periphery. This is the cartwheel appearance of the tympanic membrane. You can also see the bulged appearance of the tympanic membrane. So this condition can also be confused with some other condition like that of barotrauma or hemotympanum. As in hemotympanum also there will be redness in the tympanic membrane. But we have to differentiate this barotrauma or hemotympanum from the acute otitis media. So in case of barotrauma, there will be specific history given by the parent or by the patient himself or herself that he or she have traveled in an airplane or in a ship, or there was some swimming condition. So here there will be a proper history given. The second differential diagnosis is that of hemotympanum. Here also the history will help us to understand the type of the disease. So if the patient have any history of trauma, we can make out whether it was an traumatic cause or whether it was an infective cause. So if patient has trauma, there will be we will be directed towards the hemotympanum. But if patient had complained of upper respiratory tract infection, we will be directed towards the acute otitis media. The third is stage of suppuration. Here the congestion has been reduced, but there will be still the patient will complain of excruciating earache and hearing impairment, and there will be fever. So on otoscopic examination, when we see, we can see the bulged tympanic membrane, but the congestion is reduced. There will be accumulation of the pus posterior to the tympanic membrane with the bulged tympanic membrane. This condition has to be differentiated from the serous otitis media. Sometimes there might be a yellow pus point seen in the anteroinferior quadrant or in the posterior quadrant. The last stage is the stage of resolution. There will be resolution, as the name suggests, there will be resolution in the symptoms and the signs of the acute otitis media. So there will be resolution of the symptoms of earache, there will be resolution in the symptoms of fever, the child feels better, there will be complaint of ear discharge. On otoscopic examination, we can see that there might be presence of pus or discharge in the external auditory meatus, along with there will be reduction of the hyperemia or the congestion of the tympanic membrane. As there is discharge there, it might lead to conclusion of a perforation in the tympanic membrane. So on otoscopy examination, we have to see if there is any perforation in the tympanic membrane. It might be in the anteroinferior region or it might be in the posterior region. Now stage of complication. Along with the advent of antibiotics and early presentation of the patients, the chances of complications have been reduced. Antibiotic use has helped a lot in reducing the consequences of the acute otitis media. When there were no antibiotics, there were severe complications of the acute otitis media. So they were divided into intratemporal complications, the extratemporal complications, and the intracranial complications. Now, intratemporal complications are, there might be a tympanic membrane perforation. So if in the stage of resolution, there was a tympanic membrane perforation which led to the extrusion of the pus from the middle ear into the external auditory canal. So if this tympanic, most of the times the perforation heals by itself, but sometimes this fails to occur. So there will be a chronic tympanic membrane perforation. This is one of the most common complication of the acute otitis media. The second is acute mastoiditis. Now what is mastoiditis? Mastoid is the region posterior to the ear. It is connected with the middle ear through the adytus ad antrum. Any infection of the mastoid will be occurring because of the infection in the middle ear. It always occurs through the spread of infection of the middle ear into the mastoid region. So there will be accumulation of the pus. Patients having acute mastoiditis will have this ironing of the mastoid region with pain and tenderness, and there will be some lateralization of the pinna. Here we can see there is some lateralization of the pinna. There will be redness as well. The treatment of it is necessary and should be prompt. If treated early, there will be no further consequences or sequelae of it. The third intertemporal complication is labyrinthitis. The infection in the middle ear can spread into the inner ear. As we studied about the parts of the inner ear, that was the cochlea, the vestibule, and the semicircular canal. Now, the infection or the microorganisms or the toxins of the microorganisms can spread through the oval window or round window present in the middle ear into the internal ear, causing labyrinthitis. Patients of labyrinthitis will have vertigo and nausea. Sometimes nystagmus might also be present. Petrositis. The part of the temporal bone, one of the part of the temporal bone is the petrous part of the temporal bone. So the spread, the root of the spread of infection is similar to that of labyrinthitis, and the patient will have petrous pain, pain in the petrous region. Now, the extratemporal complications, subperiosteal abscess. Subperiosteal abscess is the second most common complication after tympanic membrane perforation. If there is acute mastoiditis and if it is not treated promptly, there might be conversion of this acute mastoiditis into a coalescent mastoiditis. Now, what is coalescent mastoiditis? Coalescent mastoiditis will have presentation after several weeks of the disease, whereas in acute mastoiditis, the patient will present within several days of the disease. So, there will be accumulation of the pus in the mastoid region along with the breakage of the septa. There will also be osteitis of the mastoid bone. So, and this osteitis will ultimately spread into the subperiosteal region. Also, the pus will spread into the subperiosteal region, leading to the abscess formation. Now, the abscess can be in several regions. It can be in the mastoid region. It can be in the upper one-third of the sternocleidomastoid, which is called basal abscess. It can be in the zygomatic region. It can be in the symbiconcal region, which is called lux abscess. It can be in the occipital region, or it can be in the submental or submandibular triangle. These are all the roots or all the locations of the subperiosteal abscess. The other complication is facial paralysis. Now, this complication is rarely seen today in current scenario, but if not treated, it can lead to facial paralysis, as there might be spread of toxins and infection from the middle ear, causing the erosion of the bony canal wall over the facial nerve, leading to the irritation of the facial nerve and facial paralysis. Once treated properly, the facial paralysis will resolve by itself. The intracranial complications are meningitis, brain abscess, extradural abscess, lateral sinus thrombophlebitis, or otitic hydrocephalus. Now, meningitis, these all conditions suggest that the infection has spread from the middle ear into the brain or into the meninges. So, patient with acute otitis media, with high grade fever, with complaining of headache, with neck rigidity, suggests that the patient has developed meningitis. So, prompt treatment is necessary in the form of IV antibiotics and lumbar puncture. Similarly, brain abscess might develop, extradural abscess might develop, lateral sinus thrombophlebitis. Now, this brain abscess and extradural abscess are very rare complications of acute otitis media. Lateral sinus thrombophlebitis is the spread of infection from the middle ear into the lateral sinus or the sigmoid sinus. For this, we have to take care that if there is pus accumulation, we have to do cortical mastoidectomy and remove the pus from the accumulated region. In the otitic hydrocephalus, it is also called benign intracranial hypertension. Here only there is raise of intracranial pressure, but there is no other complaint. There might be low grade fever. These are the complications. This is the one of the complication of facial paralysis. Now, about the management. Management of any condition includes investigation and treatment. So, first talking about the investigation, it includes culture sensitivity and blood investigation. If patient complains of ear discharge, or if the parent complains that there is ear discharge, first we have to take the culture sensitivity, and depending upon the sensitivity reports, we have to start the antibiotic or the antiviral treatment. The blood investigations will give information about the atopic conditions or about any acute bacterial conditions. If there is an acute bacterial condition, there will be leukocytosis. If there is any acute allergic condition, there will be increase in the level of the immunoglobulins or eosinophils. The treatment. Treatment is always symptomatic or definitive, as most of the time the patient complains of earache. Giving an analgesic will reduce the complaint of the earache and patient will have relieving of the symptoms. Similarly, most of the times there is a common risk factor present, which is a recurrent upper respiratory tract infection. So, for the upper respiratory tract infection, we give nasal congestant, decongestant drops. And for sometimes fever, we give antipyretics. These two to three things together will reduce the symptoms, will reduce the all the complaints and all the problems of the patient. But it will not necessarily cause, it will not necessarily cure the disease. It will not necessarily remove the bacteria or the virus causing the disease. So for that, we need a definitive medical or definitive surgical treatment. In medical treatment, we give antibiotic or antiviral depending upon the culture sensitivity. And in surgery, if the patient has refractory acute otitis media, which is not getting treated by courses of antibiotics, or if patient has excruciating pain, just to relieve the pressure and the pain in the middle ear, we do a procedure which is called myringotomy. Here in myringotomy, we make an incision in the anteroinferior quadrant or in the posterior quadrant, where we insert a grow mat, leading to the evacuation of the pus from the middle ear into the external ear. This grow mat remains within the tympanic membrane for about 6 weeks and gets extruded by itself. So, if sometimes in pre-PG examination, the question might be asked whether what is the definition of the myringotomy, what are the indications of myringotomy in acute otitis media, and in which quadrant we put an incision. So, it might be a radial incision, it might be a circumferential incision. Thank you.